Hi everyone, welcome to new video from Not Real Engineering. This is the fifth video in series Crystal Plasticity Basics. And in this video, we are going to discuss about slip versus twin. If you did not see earlier parts, all the links are in the description box below. In part one, we started with some basic concepts of crystal plasticity. In second part, we saw phenomenological models used in crystal plasticity. Part three, we talked about Euler angles. And in part four, we talked about stereographic projections and pole figures. Now let's get started with today's video. Always there are two types of deformations in crystal. One is elastic deformation, in which if you remove the load, the crystal will go back to its original shape. And another is plastic or permanent deformation, means after removing load as well, the crystal will retain its shape. And slip and twin is nothing but two types of plastic deformations. In most of the metals, deformation due to slip is very dominant. So you can see almost all the time, whenever you hear about plastic deformation in metal, it is due to slipping. And deformation due to slip is observed in all metals. On the other hand, deformation due to twin is not that dominant, and it is observed only in some metals and also at some specific temperatures. So you can see twin is kind of rare. As slip is very common, there are many mathematical models available for slip, and they are comparatively easy. And mathematical models for twin are a little bit difficult. Now let's see how exactly slip works. This is just a basic 2D representation. Actually, crystal is always in 3D. So this over here is our initial configuration. These blue circles are atoms, and these red lines are bond between atoms. As it's a crystal, atoms are arranged in highly orderly structure. And when we apply a shear load on this, like this, these atoms get rearranged in this form. This is equivalent to these atoms are slipping over each other. That's why it is called slip. And you can see that each horizontal row of atom is displaced towards right by one atomic distance. If you consider, let's say, this much area in initial configuration, and then if you consider the same kind of area in deform configuration, these both areas are exactly same. Therefore, orientation of crystal did not change. It just the atoms got displaced. In this area, the middle atom, now in this area, that middle atom became this side atom. But the orientation is exactly same, structure is exactly same. And that's why when load is removed, the material can stay in that form, because that is lowest potential energy form. And as there is no change in crystal orientation, there is no formation of grain boundary. If you see these two pictures over here, a crystalline material without any grain boundary is nothing but orientation of that crystal is same everywhere. But if orientation changes, then the boundary at which two crystals with different orientation meet each other, that is called grain boundary. Therefore, here there is no grain boundary. Orientation is exactly same. Now you must have heard at many places that everyone says plastic deformation in crystal occurs due to movement of dislocation. When they say this, mostly it is pertaining to slip. Plastic deformation due to slip. And I also did not understand for a long time why it is like that. I understood what is slip, but why it has to be because of movement of dislocations. So to understand that, let's consider just only this area. Let me go to next slide. Okay, now we are considering only these two lines. Let me separate them. So this is how it is in initial configuration. We are applying shear load. Therefore, the first horizontal row of atoms is pulled in this direction, and the top atom row is pulled in this direction. Now when atoms start to slip, it does not happen like all these bonds will get broken at a single time and atoms will move to the next location and then they will form bond again. It does not happen like that, because if all the bonds are broken at a single time, that means it is just like a crack. If all the bonds are broken, then this is like two pieces of metals just kept on top of each other. Therefore, it doesn't work like this. What happens is the first step is only this bond will get broken. And the top atom will displace a little bit. Then in second step, this bond will get broken. This atom will move again. And then this atom will form a bond with this atom. So you can see over here. And again, this atom will get displaced a little bit. But still the bond between this atom and this atom will be intact, as shown over here. Now, if you observe this configuration closely, this is a dislocation. Remember the dislocation types, line dislocation, surface dislocation. So out of that, this is line dislocation. And specifically, this is edge dislocation. This is exactly same as this. Now, in next step, what will happen is this atom will break its bond with this atom and form bond with this atom. And this process will go on. So now in next step, this atom will break its bond with this atom and form bond with this atom, which will be represented as this. And this process will go on till finally it is rearranged in this way. And now if you track that dislocation, this is the dislocation in step 4, this is the dislocation in step 5, similarly step 6 and step 7. This is the same dislocation, it looks exactly same. And it looks like it is moving from right to left. And slip always occurs like this. A dislocation will get created at one end and it will travel from one end to another end. And then when it reaches the another end, then it will get dissolved. So here that dislocation got dissolved. And that's why people say slip is because of movement of dislocation. Now let's go to twin. Again for twinning, consider this as a initial configuration. Now again we are applying shear force like this. Now see the difference. When you apply a shear force and when twinning occurs, atoms rearrange themselves in this configuration. And if you consider a unit cell in this initial configuration, which looks like this, in untwinned area, the unit cell will look same. This is exactly same. But if you see the twinned region, this red area is known as twinned zone. In that also, the unit cell looks exactly same. The only difference is orientation. So if you rotate this unit cell, you will get this unit cell. And as orientation is same, that's why it is stable and atoms can stay in that configuration forever. And as you saw before, if you compare this situation with these two pictures, this is a single crystal and this is a polycrystal. So the grain boundary is nothing but where crystals with two different orientation meet each other. And that's what exactly happening over here. Therefore, this black line is called as grain boundary. Orientation of crystal in this blue zone is different and in red zone is different. And hence this grain boundary is created. And always whenever twinning occurs, two grain boundaries will get created. Because again, at some point, it will switch back to its original configuration. So when you applied shear force in this blue area, nothing happened. But the atoms in this red area arranged in such a way that the different grain orientation got formed. And it will be always like if you take a mirror image of this blue structure about this black axis, that is the grain boundary, you will get this red structure. So this is a mirror. And one side is mirror image of another side. And this process happens simultaneously. Bonds are not broken. It is just the orientation. Means if you consider this bond between these two atoms, those two atoms were over here first. Now the bond is not broken. Just they changed the location. Earlier in the unit cell, they were forming the shortest side. Now in unit cell, they are forming the longest side. And as this process happens quickly, it is faster than slip and also it produces some sound. And after twinning, you can observe the grain boundaries. Now let's see some differences between slip and twin. This picture over here shows slip. This picture over here shows twin. Of course, the first difference is crystal lattice orientation is same after slipping, but crystal lattice orientation is different after twinning in twin zone, which means this red part. Slip is a line defect, whereas twin is a surface defect. Slip is commonly observed in BCC and FCC metals. In HCP also slip is observed. So you can say slip is observed in all type of metals, but twin commonly observed only in HCP metals. For atoms to rearrange themselves in a such a way that one side is a mirror image of another side, that cannot happen for all crystal types. For FCC, you can't just do that. That can only happen for HCP. Then stress required for slipping is comparatively low than stress required for twinning. Slip is most dominant plastic deformation. Twin is observed for some metals and also for some specific temperature and usually for low temperatures. Slip occurs in milliseconds. That means it is a very slow process and twin occurs very fast in microseconds. While slipping, no sound is created. While twinning, a clicking sound is created, which is also known as tin cry. Under microscope, you can see slip as a thin lines, but twinning is seen as thick lines. In slip, all atoms move same distance, which is one atomic distance. But in twinning, distance moved by atom depends on their location from twin plane. For example, this atom and this atom will move same distance, but this atom will move different distance. And again, distance moved by this atom and this atom will be same. Stress required to propagate the slip is usually higher than stress required to start the slip. And for twin, it is exactly opposite. Stress required to propagate the twin is usually lower than stress required to start the twin. And final difference is, slip occurs at low strain rates, but twin occurs at high strain rates. And finally, let's see when twinning occurs. I mean, some real life examples of twinning. First of all, as we discussed, twinning occurs in HCP packed materials. Some examples are magnesium, zirconium, and tin. Again, slip occurs at low temperature. And if you consider from crystal plasticity simulations point of view, in many cases, you can ignore the twinning. You can just consider plastic deformation due to slip, and it will give you pretty accurate answers. This graph shows over here the variation of critical shear stress versus temperature. This is the critical resolved shear stress required to start plastic deformation. So if you consider high temperature region, over here you can see the critical shear required to start slip is much lower than critical shear required to start twin. Therefore, you will not observe twinning at this temperature. But as you reduce the temperature, the critical shear required to start the slip will go on increasing, and at some point it will become more than twin. Therefore, if you consider some low temperature, here you will observe twinning because critical stress required to start twin is less than critical stress required to start slip. Again, there is a difference between slip at high strain rate and slip at low strain rate. So depending on strain rate also, it will change. And finally, I just want to point out to one very good video on YouTube. Its name is Tin Cry and Mechanical Twinning. Over here, you can actually see the experiments. This is a tin bar and the lady over here bends it. And when you bend the tin bar, plastic deformation occurs in it. And if you do this for low temperature tin bar, then you can hear that clicking sound because of twinning. And that's why it is called as tin cry. But if you bend the tin bar at high temperature, you will not hear any sound because all the plastic deformation will occur because of slipping. I will link this video in the description box below. Please go and check it out, so you will get even better understanding of slipping and twinning. For future videos in this series, we will see some mathematical models for twinning. We will also see some physics-based crystal plasticity constitutive model. We already saw phenomenological-based crystal plasticity models in part 2. So in future, we will see physics-based. We will also have a video about dislocations in crystal and dislocation density. We will see some tutorial to create complex microstructures using software Napier. And of course, complex crystal plasticity simulations using all these softwares, Warp 3D, Napier simulation module, Damask, Abacus, and Moods. So that's it for this video. If you have any questions, please let me know in the comment section below. If you like this video, please go to this channel's homepage to see similar video. You can also find many videos related to other topics in computational mechanics. Please don't forget to subscribe to show your support. And as always, thank you for watching.